Good afternoon, everyone. Our next lecture for today is by Dr. Prakash Kurenga. Dr. Prakash is an assistant professor at our Department of Animal Biotechnology, Anand Agriculture University. So his education qualifications include, he is a BBSc and MBSc from the Department of Biotechnology, College of Veterinary Science and Animal Husbandry, AU. He has been a gold medalist in his BBSc. He has also done his PhD from the Department of Animal Biotechnology, AU. His experiences include, he is working as an assistant professor at our department since 2006. Awards and achievements, he has cleared GPSC class 1 and class 2 exams, also cleared CSIR NET and ERS NET exams. He has got membership in American Society of Microbiology, Gujarat Veterinary Council of India. He has more than 25 publications in reputed journals. I request sir.
Good afternoon to all of you. My professor used to tell me that a common man cannot concentrate more than 45 minutes. So I try to restrict myself within 45 minutes. And again, it's lunchtime, so it's difficult to listen. So I will keep 15 minutes for interactive session, but I will speak for 45 minutes only. And probably this is the last chance where you can solve your queries if at all it is available with you. Otherwise, now everything will be closed. And my lecture is nothing new. It's a challenge associated with analysis of metagenomic data. My previous speaker in last 8 days, they have talked about so much about problems they have faced in their own field. So what I will do is I will try to compile everything in a systemic manner. Those whosoever has
very good.
I will try to compare all the challenges which were expressed by many of the scientists in their own field, yet in a systemic manner. And I will offer a possible solution based on my own experience, knowledge and expertise, that these are the possible solution of all challenges. May not be 100% true, many of you might not be agree to that also, but it is based on my own experience only. As we all know, metagenomic studies are data rich, both in terms of amount of data and complexity of data. So we need some standardized pipeline to analyze this data to draw some meaningful conclusion out of that, so then we can interpret that data and that can be useful for society. Otherwise, to publish a paper, submit your data to NGRAST and draw some good diagram and publish paper, that is different thing. But to understand and use, to scientifically use that data in day-to-day life, we need to understand each and everything. So I will whatever flood of data produced by next generation sequencing technology needs some standardized procedure. But so far we don't have that. We'll see each and everything, each and every aspect in detail. See, this is, all of you are agreed to me that microbes are important part of life. And these are the few examples of services which are provided by microbes to us. Starting from here, it removes carbon dioxide from atmosphere and produce oxygen in atmosphere, or ozone layer present in stratosphere. It is thought to be because of microbes, of early microbes only. We have enough discussion of gut microbes. Some specialized bacteria in a specialized place, they are transferring dinitrogenous into ammonia. Soil microbes, most common source of antibiotic and many more, fermentation, food and all. So these are some examples. But what I mean to say is, looking to this only, we are telling it that microbes are important part of life. But this is 1% only. That is what everybody is doing. That means still 99% needs to be explored, and that's why metagenomic is important. Though I am highlighting most of the part, my 70% part is highlighting the drawbacks associated with metagenome, but the metagenomic study are important. This is how I am justifying my talk. Otherwise, you will feel that it's negatively biased. This is the first line in actual paper of Anderson where she quoted the terms metagenome. She was studying soil microflora, and there she named a community as a metagenome. And this was the first actual line from paper itself where she used term metagenome. The discovery of metagenome, see, this was paper published in 1998. From there you calculate the year up to 2030, and here cost per millions of base pair. You see, in 1998 to 2001, cost was approximately $10,000 USD per millions of bases. That was mainly dideoxygen termination method, and that too with single capillary or maximum 4 or 16 capillary. But look at here specifically. In 2007, the first time GSFLX rose, 4-5. Initially, it was a company called 4-5 for life science. They introduced a machine called GSFLX. And from there, there will be drastic reduction in cost. From 1000 or 700 USD per million, directly it came to 100. Later on, in just after 2 years, in 2009 or 2010, Illumina came up with HiSeq machine. And again, cost was reduced. And this is mainly because of only single technology that is called as Illumina. Decrease from here to here, from 10 to 0.1 USD per million, is mainly because of Illumina only. GSFLX titanium, still they are holding the same rate. In 2007, 2008, rate of one kit was 9,700 USD, and that time dollar was somewhere around 42, 43, 45. Still they are holding the same rate, 9,700 USD per kit, but now dollar price is 62, 63, 61 at least. So for Indian condition, they are, rather than decreasing the price, they have increased the price. And but Illumina, they are reducing the price like anything. They have started with HiSeq, then they have launched HiSeq 2, HiSeq 3, Genome Analyzer 2, Genome Analyzer 3, then MySeq, and now recently they have launched NextSeq. So each and every machine has got some advantage, some disadvantage. We will discuss in detail about each and every technology. What are the advantages, what are the disadvantages associated with this. But this drastic reduction in this sequencing cost ultimately resulted in increase in amount of data. Initially, to study a metagenome, everybody was collaborating. Somebody will collect the sample, some other institute will do sequencing, two or three institute together will go for sequencing, and one institute, bioinformatics institute, they will analyze the data. So it was international collaborative projects. But now it is shifted from international to individual laboratory projects. Because of reduced in sequencing cost and some of the web-based software tools which are available for data analysis. And look at the number of publications. When you are putting in PubMed, I try to put metagenome star. What do you mean? What do you mean by this?
Associated.
Whenever you are putting the star, that means it could be metagenomic, MIC, it could be metagenome, everything will be searched. And you see, but now, increase in number of publications. Initially it was 1, 2, 3 or 5 like that. From 2007, 200, 250, 273, 290, 330 like this. And now it is 600. And I think Ajay has shown data that in 2014 it was 1,500 publications. So every year number of publication is getting doubled. And this shows the interest of scientists in field of metagenomics. See, a typical metagenomic project. This is a design of a typical metagenome project. You collect the sample, extract nucleic acid out of that, go for sequencing technology, DNA sequencing using either of these technology. Assemble your data, annotate your data, go for some statistic analysis to draw some meaningful conclusion out of that, store your data somewhere either in your server or use server of somebody else. If you are interested in comparative metagenomics, share your data with somebody. Like MGRAST, at MGRAST also you are sharing some data with somebody. So, but every place, these two terminology you will see, metadata and binning. These are two important. We will see problem faced during each and every phase of this typical metagenomic project. So we are starting with sample collection. Dr. Joshi has discussed enough about sample collection, but still I would like to recall, there won't be any standardized method for sample collection. What to collect, from where to collect, how to collect. And again, density, diversity and dynamics of microflora at particular location is ever changing. At what time you have taken sample, after 1 hour it might get changed. So it is always a problem again. Whatever sample you have collected, is it a true representative sample, you are not sure. Is it representing all the organisms present in that particular community? Whatever, see, the possible solution to this is either you take replicates, two or three replicates of the same sample. In that case, you can say whatever I have collected, that is enough. But when you are putting replicates in metagenomic study, that means you are increasing your cost twice or three times higher directly. That's why everybody is not preferring to have replicates of their samples. That means sample collection itself is a standardization, standardization and standardization. Neither of this is correct or neither of this is wrong. All are correct. Whatever way you have corrected your sample, that is true. Consider this and go ahead with this. The possible solution is you can use biological replicates, then you will give your reason. The first and foremost requirement is initially you design your experiments and then start data collection or sample collection. Then whatever result you are getting, that will be more meaningful. And most of the people are getting failed because of this only. They are not designing or designing experiment. At the time of design only you decide which sample I will take, how much sample I will take, how much read I will produce, which technology I will use, how I will analyze my data. Rather than this is the approximate budget. This happens with everybody, with me also. At the time of proposing project, we are not aware with bioinformatics software, neither with sequencing technology, nor with data sample collection. We'll collect this much amount of ruminal fluids. We are not sure how much we'll collect from them, how we'll extract the DNA and all. So this is the most important part. You design your experiment and then start your experiment actually. The solution available to this sample collection itself, not 100%, but you maintain your metadata. That means data about your own data. Whatever you have collected, that should have some meaningful parameter with this. Like, see, this is Genome GSC, Genome Standards Consortium. It has given some minimum guidelines that these are the minimum information which is required for metagenomic sequences. If you are depositing your sequences to NCBI, gradually, right now it is not mandatory. That means if you wish, you can give some samples, some information. But later on, what I feel is within 2-3 years, it will be mandatory. Because without this checklist, they have given checklist and they are updating. See, this is a website, Genome Standard Consortium. And I have taken checklist just before few days. They are updating checklist on weekly basis or fortnightly. That is how we can maintain uniformity between two experiments. That I am doing metagenome of soil, somebody else is doing metagenome of soil in Canada, and somebody else is doing soil metagenome in USA. So what will be the uniformity? This much parameter is necessary. You mention everything with this, and that by using this, if you are following this principle, right now see everybody is encouraging that all scientists should follow this guidelines. All scientists should fill up this much detail, or they should get this much detail. Sometimes it may not be possible to collect all detail, or maybe some other reasons, but right now everybody is not following. But till then, right now also, if you are publishing your paper in some good journal, they will look for this, that whether you have followed Miami or not. Without that, they will not accept your paper. And what do you mean by this rare rarefaction curve? I think you have seen so many times, rare rarefaction curve. What is utility of rare rarefaction curve in metagenome sequencing data? Who will tell me?
We can stop somewhere where the data becomes clashed, and after that there won't be any variation or something.
All
like
the
that.
Rare species are inclusive in the data as far as we have analyzed it.
Number of
reference species. So information about the species that have been covered in your analysis so far. If it is, if it is saturated, we can see the saturation. From the saturation itself, we can say that okay, enough of the. From these rates, these many rates have been, these many species have been covered. That is possible.
That is, madam, answer of that question. How much data to produce? See, I have taken unknown metagenome.
Yeah.
For that, I am generating some reads. Now, where to stop?
Once it reaches to the saturation stuff. One saturation stuff.
See, this is classical example. Okay. 5,000 reads, you forget about this. 5,000 reads for 6 metagenomes. Now, operation taxonomic unit assigned to this file. When you have taken, produced 5,000 reads, red is giving approximately 3000 operational taxonomic units, whereas this one is giving 1500. Okay. Now you are adding 5000 more reads to them. That means 10,000 reads. Now you see the increase. 10,000 reads over here. From 3000, now it is 4500. Okay, that means theoretically it should be doubled. When you have doubled your rates, it should be 6,000, but it is 4,500 only. Whereas here it was 1,500, even after reading this, it was 2,500. Like, you had again 1,500 reads. When you are reaching to flare 2, that means even after adding your reads, your operational taxonomic units are not increasing. That means whatever data you have produced, that is enough. This is one indicator only. With this also, you are not sure that you have missed some of the organisms which are very low abundance. But at least you will get the idea that I have covered most of the species which are available with this. When your increase will not be significant. And this happens, this is real data, that's why you see. With 10,000 reads, 10 million reads, this will be the picture. Again, after adding of 10,000 more reads, again at 10,000 more reads, number of species identified, it will show some plateau. And this is how we will decide that whatever data, amount of data I have produced, that is enough. Now we need not to produce any data, more amount of data, you go for analysis. That means rarefaction curve will give idea about how much data is to be produced with whatever will be the technology. See, the another step is, after sample collection, it's a nucleic acid extraction. DNA or RNA extraction procedure has its own bias with respect to sample loss or preference lysis. Okay. It has bias according to either due to sample loss or due to some preference lysis. If you are using lysozyme, it will break the bacterial cell membrane. If you are using chitinase, it will lyse some other cell membrane. Okay, if you are using some mechanical shearing forces, the eukaryotic cells which are larger in size, that may get ruptured, but not the smaller size cells, like bacteria. And this is not my observation. Oh, that type of observation has been made in so many papers. See, this is the paper which was published in Applied and Environmental Microbiology, Assessment of Bias Associated with Incomplete Extraction of Microbial DNA from Soil. Another paper, Comparison of DNA Extraction Method for Microbial Community Profiling and Application of Pediatric Bronchoalveolar Lavage Sample. See, all these papers, they are reflecting the bias associated with nucleic acid extraction procedure. Whatever technology you are using, but it is introducing some bias. Bias during DNA extraction from activated slug sample revealed by high throughput sequencing. Extraction of DNA from soil. Comparison of DNA extraction kit for PCR DGG analysis. DNA, this is again. And I will request all of you to go through this paper. This paper was published in Nature Biotechnology. It's a genome sequencing of rare uncultured bacteria obtained by differential coverage binning of multiple metagenome. Here also they have used two different methods for DNA extraction.
Which year this?
2013. I have copy of this paper. This is paid one, but you can get anywhere you get. Albertson, 2013. It's a nice paper. What they did is they have taken some sample from soil. There they have taken two different methods of DNA extraction. One was, I think, from MP Biomedical. They have used heat only, one. In that they have used phenol, which is at normal temperature. In another one, they have used hot phenol. So in paper you will find HP plus and HP minus. I think I am having one slide also. HP plus and HP minus. Hot phenol they have used, so HP plus. Hot phenol they have not used, simple that means instruction given by manufacturer they have followed, that is HP minus. And by using both this method, they have generated huge amount of data, and from there they have constructed the genome. So it was like genome reconstruction. In one they got, I think, 31 genomes, and in another they got 12 genomes. So it tells about how DNA extraction will produce bias. See, again, whether you are storing your sample, bias may be dependent on this also. You are storing your sample, at what temperature you are storing your sample, which method of DNA extraction you are using, is it bead beating or magnetic bead-based separation, or filter-based separation, and ultimately how much amount of data you are getting out of it. If you are getting less amount of data, that means their chances will be more that you are missing some of the species which is having low abundance. If you are getting higher amount of data, that means there are chances that you will get some of the reeds from low abundance species. See, this is classical example, which was, this paper is also published in 2001 by Su and et al. What they did is they have taken 10 bacteria, 10 species of bacteria. Some are gram positive, some are gram negative. Even GC was, GC percent was also varying, GC plus higher percentage as well as lower percentage. They have mixed bacteria according to their genome size in equal proportion. And they have given to three different laboratories that you use your own method and go for DNA extraction. And you see the variation which was available. Now all these three laboratories, they have mentioned name also then, to whom they have given. They are well-regulated laboratory, they have used their own standardized protocol, and then also you see the variation available with this. Neither of them is showing constant result. Even within laboratory also they are not showing constant result. You see, this is first set, this is another laboratory and this is another laboratory. Lactobacillus lactis. You see the representation of Lactobacillus lactis over here. You compare with other technologies. This is how, see, we are about to introduce this DNA in metagenomic study, and based on this we are drawing some conclusion that this is in abundance, this is in low abundance, or it is playing major role, this is major part of the, that particular community. This is how it will take. That's why replication is necessary, and the biggest thing is comparative data analysis. You compare two genomes from two different species, if you are getting same value, then validity will be more. You see the result they got for 10 bacteria. Here they have mentioned the name also. This is another one, that paper itself, Albertson 2013. Hot phenol plus, they have used phenol at 90 degree for 3 minute treatment they have given to soil, and then they have extracted DNA, and this is hot phenol minus. That means empty biomedical kits without modifying their protocols they have used. And you see the number of organisms they are getting. This is how DNA extraction itself will produce variations, diversity in your metagenome. Whatever you are telling it is a diversity, that may be because of their extraction procedure itself.
For 9 days you have been telling metagenomics.
No, if you wait for perfect time, if we wait for perfect time, we can't do anything. You think it positively, though we are getting less also, but we are identifying 4 organisms. Okay, but this is the true picture, yeah, how it is affecting. And this was published in Nature, so it has got some validity. And again, this was published in Nature. It's a classical paper. Culture press changing the central dogma of microbial diversity. I think it is later only. This article is having 2 or 3 pages only. But it is worth to read. These 7 are different communities, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. I will name them also. The first one is endodontic pathogenic oral biofilm, second one is exodontic oral biofilm, third one is lake sample, fourth one is rhizoplane, fifth one is bird feeder, sixth one is ocean, and seventh is our hypersaline salt runs. Okay, that means 7 diverse communities they have taken. What they did is, they have isolated, they did cultural isolation. So these are 16S RRN based study. This is based on 16S RRN or 16S RDNA. That means they are getting, by using molecular techniques, they are getting 26. See, they are it was in 2007. So they haven't used next generation sequencing technology. This was the organism, they have taken sample, applied universal primer and identified diversity. They got 26 species, and this is based on culture studies, 19. Now, this is overlapping one. That means 20s were identified in by this also and by this also. So this is mainly because of abundance only. See, otherwise, 19, that means these are the species which are uniquely present in culture-based study only. They didn't got represented in 16S RDNA study. Otherwise, you think practically it should be represented over here. Vice versa may not be true, but this should be represented over here. Look at here, 10 to 5 species. this is lake sample. 25 species which are uniquely present in culture-based studies only. 8 got uniquely represented via 16S rDNA study. And none of the species was commonly present in both species.
How is that possible?
This is possible, sir. They have given reference. That's why I am telling you, go through this paper. And this is mainly because of what they are telling is because of whatever we are thinking that higher and lower abundance may not be the actually true. Lower means it can be too low. See, this could be the reason over here. These are the 25 species might be having too low abundance, which won't be represented over here. You may not be able to extract DNA out of them. This could be the reason. We could not be able to extract DNA out of this species, which was got extracted over here. Abundance might be too high for this species. And again, you see the variation. Even these two are oral metagenome, that's why they are sharing some similarity over here. But look at here, 147, 159, and only 8 are present in both of them. That's why I'm telling you, go through this paper, Donachi, in 2007. This is in Nature again. See, this was, we are considering that we are taking purified culture and problem associated with bacteria, different species of bacteria. But you think about other eukaryotes. If your sample is getting contaminated with other eukaryotes, so far whatever we have seen, that is extraction bias associated with bacterial pure cultures only. But it was not the exact situation. In your metagenome, your sample might be contaminated with so many other things, like eukaryotes. And in special in eukaryote, what I want to highlight is, you see these two figures. Bacterium having size of 4.5 million bases and width 16,000 millions of bases. That means, in context to size, one human cell, one mammalian cell, that is equivalent to 750 Escherichia coli. That means by chance, if your sample is contaminated with 1000 mammalian cells, your bacterial diversity will be gone. Okay. And most of the times our samples are contaminated with plants, which are having even higher genome size than human. So 1 week sample is equivalent to 3555 E. coli. Now you see what will happen to lower abundance organisms. They will never be represented in your sample. And again the problem is, we are not taking all amount, whatever DNA you extracted, that we are not subjecting to next generation sequencing. Each and every system has got some requirement, 500 nanogram, 1 nanogram, 1 microgram or 500 nanogram like that. That means out of this also you are taking some amount of DNA that might not be true representative of your DNA extraction procedure. So there are some machines which are giving that we are starting with lower quantity also. That might be feasible for some of you, but at that cost, when you are taking lesser amount of data, that means you are missing some of the DNA, which are in lower abundance. DNA extraction process requires specific protocols for each type of sample. This is true. The DNA extraction procedure which we are using for rumen cannot be used for soil metagenome. Sequencing, this was one observation by one scientist that sequencing technology choice has six-fold less impact than varying input DNA amount in metagenomic study. That means whatever sequencing technology you are using, that is not having much affection, rather than whatever amount of DNA you are giving to this, that has got six times higher impact than this. Again, genome size of individual, that is average genome size, that equals average genome size of your community will also have some effect. It will create some bias in your result. See, the possible solution, whether it is possible or not, but the possible solution is different laboratories should use same protocol. If you are using soil metagenome, if there are some groups at international level, they are telling for soil metagenome you use this protocol, in that case you can compare your results. At least you can compare results between the two different groups. If you are using two different protocols, that means though you are publishing your paper, but for actual reality you cannot compare two results. if the target community is associated with host, in that case either you go for selective lysis. For bacteria you use lysozyme, so you want lyse mammalian cells, or else if you are interested in fungal diversity, use chitinase enzyme, so you get most of the fungal DNA. Like that you can use, or you, according to size, go for filtration and then take your sample. Okay, it means separation of prokaryotic and eukaryotic DNA is must if you are actually looking, targeting some community for some specific purpose only. And based on that Donach study, now they have decided that only molecular biology based on 16S rRNA or next generation sequencing is not enough. With this, you should go for some culture based study also, where culturable entities having low abundance can be represented. So only next generation sequencing technology.
So in that case, that will give you rather more complete picture. That if you are complementing your sequencing data along with culture data.
Yes.
One more question is that in this new generation sequencing platform, they recommend the initial concentration like 100 nanogram,
yes.
200 nanogram. How higher concentration? Because we have two problems. One, by starting with such a low concentration comparatively, they are saying that we are missing low abundance organism. So how this concentration? One possible straightforward solution seems to be that we can increase the concentration. But in that case, the platform manufacturer don't recommend that. So how
you can solution to that is you prepare more number of libraries.
Okay.
Then pull your libraries and then go for analysis.
Okay, so you mean to say from the same sample, we need to prepare more libraries.
More number of libraries.
And using a common extraction protocol.
Yes, see, that usually happens with everybody. If you are giving your sample to somebody and if you tell that you produce 1000 MB data in a single library, that means your procedure is biased. You have prepared library and same library you are using 10 times. One run is giving 100 MB data, you make 10 runs and you are getting 1000 MB data. But from same library. Rather than that, the best exercise is you tell them that you prepare 10 libraries, produce 100 MB data of each library and then put everything.
Okay.
This night they are working for, they have taken 1000 of the samples from different ecosystems and they are designing some protocols which is suitable for all community, all ecosystems. They have taken 1000 of sample and again they have taken mixer, means they are putting physical, chemical and mechanical lysis also, enzymatic lysis also, freezing and thawing also. That means they are putting everything together, physical, chemical and enzymatic lysis. They are using all types of enzyme also. That means they are in process of designing a protocol which is suited to all ecosystems. If that protocol is getting accepted to everybody, in that case at far extent we are producing data which is equally produced, that means which are produced unbiased. This group is pioneer in designing DNA extraction procedure only for specially metagenomes. The laboratory is specially looking for this only. I have seen that they are using everything, physical lysis, chemical freezing and thawing also, heating, freezing, thawing, even with some enzyme treatment. That means they are putting everything together so that you can extract DNA present in your system.
What is the reference for
Night? Night? You go for Night 2013 metagenome DNA extraction methods. We have seen enough about DNA sequencing system. I think this is known to each and everybody, so I won't discuss in detail. But let me clarify that all this method, whether it is genome analyzer, any of the system, genome analyzer 2, 3, MySeq, NextSeq, GSFLX, GSFLX Titanium Plus, ABI Solid, IonTorrent PGM, IonProton 2, 3, anything. All methods are having one step, that is called as emulsion PCR or cluster generation. That is PCR only. And when you are using PCR dependent method, that means you are creating bias itself. Now we are moving to third step. So there will be always some regions which are impossible or difficult to amplify. And this is the simple example which everybody must have faced. When you are going for PCR, for some sample you will amplify your DNA, for some you are not getting amplification with same primer with good quality of DNA. Okay, that may be because of composition of that particular region, maybe GC percentage might be high, you need to you change your enzyme, some other tech, fusion tech or something else, you will amplify your region. You will get amplification in that region. Again, from beginning itself, if your copy number is high and you are subjected in that sample for PCR, that means you have created again a bias. If your DNA is having higher concentration, that means it will be exponentially amplified during PCR itself, so organism having lower abundance will not be represented in your sequencing. So all the methods which are based having this step, emulsion PCR or cluster generation, that itself will create a bias. And ion torrent is having two times amplification, so it will add more bias. Though they are telling that we are producing some amplification only up to increase the amount of library, but itself they are creating bias. Though it will be 4 cycles only or 5 cycles only, then also it will create bias.
Does the length of amplicons also create some bias?
Yes, sir. If one is having 2 kb size and another one is having 200 base pair size,
although suppose the initial concentration is the same.
Yes.
Suppose I start with 100 nanogram per microliter.
Initial copy number is same, not concentration.
Okay. Copy number is the same. Right. So even if the length of one of the amplicon that I expect is more, so that is also going to induce bias.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
In favor of
lower size fragments.
Okay.
That happens with everybody. If you go for 2000 base pair amplification, most of the time you see critically, everybody is putting 34 cycle or 35 cycle. If you are amplifying 2000 base pair in your PCR, 30 will be enough. This is just because of that bias only. And 30 and 34 cycles, it has two huge difference. Last 4 cycle, copy will be almost billion times higher. This is generally happens with higher size fragments. If you are amplifying 1500 base pair fragment, any gene like deficiency gene or anything, you are putting 33-34 cycles. But if your amplicon size is 200 base pair, you will take 30 cycles, 28 cycles, 31 cycles will be enough. And see, this is practical example of this. Even after having this much coverage, this much region didn't got amplified. Otherwise, whatever library you have created, that was random. Trimming again you have done. There are some problems associated either with this or this region, because of which we are not getting a single read in this region. Whatever we are getting, that will be starting from here or it is ending over here. That means, see, what do you mean by coverage? Genome coverage, they are telling 5x.
5 times the data of its genome size.
That means statistically, each base present in your genome should read 5 times. But practically it won't be true. There are some bases which are read 10 times, and there are some bases which are represented 2 times or may not be represented even a single time. Seen one or two study, Smith and Whitmer has seen that this is the ideal situation which Ross has given, and might be true for other systems also. They are using one primer for emulsion PCR and one for sequencing. They are having some key and here is your library fragment. This is ideal situation. Every time we are telling that this will be the ideal situation. But you are putting everything together. So many fragments at a time with DNA ligase, adapter and film. So there are possibilities like this. Fragment 1 itself will get ligated with fragment 2, and now whatever you are from both the ends, primer will get ligated. So this is possibility. If you have such situation arise, that means whatever reads will be generated, that will be chimeric reads. It won't be the actual reads, but reads generated from two different fragments. Again, possibility will be like this. Like these two articles, they are telling that because of this, whatever data they are getting, that means this was based on GSFLX only, both these papers. They have identified 6% or 5% chimeric reads because of this only. They are getting adapter sequences between the two fragments. and again everything is getting amplified. So there is a PCR chimera. There the sequence is formed from two or more biological samples joined together. An amplicon with chimeric sequences can form during the PCR when incomplete extension happens. Next, during next extension cycle, the fragments will again be amplified and it will generate the reads which is not the actual one. This is comparison of different sequencing methods. So, I compared with Sanger sequencing technology, biosequencing, GSFLX, ion torrent PGM. This one was solid, now no one is using, but you have seen this machine in Excelvis, solid. And this is for Illumina. Each system has got advantage as well as disadvantage. Though the data output in Sanger sequencing system is less, but still we are using the Sanger sequencing system, where your requirement is to go for sequencing of two or three samples only. And again, read length is thought to be highest till date. GSFLX, now they are claiming up to 700 base pair, but practically you can say you are getting mean read length of 500 base pair, though the longest read length could be 1500. And this is total output of data, whatever you are getting, in comparison with read length. Each system has got some advantage, some disadvantage. Like say here you are getting longest reads, even in some repetitive regions also. But data output is too less to go for colony picking, again cycle sequencing and electrophoresis is tedious job as compared to NGS technologies. If you are using GSFLX reads, then read length will be high, technology is again proven, whatever data you are getting that is accurate one. But it has got some problem in identifying homopolymeric region or sequencing homopolymeric region where there will be stretches of single nucleotide. System has got error over there. If you will go for ion torrent PGM, again the cheapest sequencing system available in market right now. Data output is also good. You are getting 1500 MB data and this is practically 1.5 GB data we are also getting in our lab. Even we are getting 2 GB, 2.2 GB data. But the problem associated with this is, see, this was older slide, that's why I have taken yet to be proven. That EBI person was telling that for metagenomic study you don't use ion torrent. Okay. So that's the problem. Accuracy is less. Again, the same problem in homopolymeric region which was associated with this GSFLX. Same problem here also it is. But it has got some advantage. If you are going for resequencing of your genome, better to use this. Cheaper machines, even machines are available at so many places in India. They are regularly supplying chemicals and consumables as compared to other systems where you need to wait for at least a month to get your kit. This is now nobody is using, though it was having highest accuracy, but read length was too low, 75 base pair. So it was not much useful for annotation and all. This is the best system as far as my personal experience is concerned, where you are compromising two things. Read length. Now it is 300 base pair. 300 base pair read length with MySeq. Even cheaper, accurate one, and it has no problem in identifying homopolymeric regions. Okay. And that's because of this only. If you compare the world market share in NGS, they are sharing 68% or 70% of market share. And rest 30% GSFLX, ion torrent, ion proton, helicos, take by everybody's place. Illumina is taking 68 to 70% here.
Even in India?
See, in India scenario is different. I think ion torrent is, they are having more number of installations throughout the India. Ion torrent. See, these people are rigid. That we won't go for negotiation. This is the price of machine. If you wish to buy, you can buy, otherwise forget it. But you ask these people, they will tell that if you are using consumable of 1 crore rupees, we will put machine at 3 of 4. But
no, Illumina, another problem is
supply of
kits. The company is not directly in India and it is through the supplier. And distributors are good, then you will be happy. Otherwise, again, you will be in trouble. Though Illumina is known technology, in India, it will be failure. You will find very less installations because the consumable supply is not regular. You have to wait for the consumable supply. Like Cygenome and other companies, they are getting consumer directly from abroad. They are not dealing through the vendors, Indian vendors.
Even for our workshop, the person from Illumina told that I am ready to demonstrate my system. But the problem is, you need to order a kit, and that will take at least a month. We are ready to order also. We told them we will pay for your kits if you have any single one or two kit extra with you. You use that kit, we will pay for it. But he told you need to order the kits, and that will take at least a month. And that's why number of installation of ion torrent, they are higher in India. Choice of sequencing chemistry depends on mainly this one. How much budget you are having. How much budget you want to spend for your metagenome sequencing. The another one is how much accurate data you need. If you have enough budget, go for system which is giving accurate data. How much data output you are needing? That means whether you are going for resequencing of genome, metatranscriptome, metagenome. Based on application, you can select the system. Again, read length. If your application is transcriptome, this much read will be enough. If it is resequencing, this will be enough. If you need metagenomic, high read length will be okay. De novo sequencing, I need the highest read length. Everything depends upon this. And the possible solution for that PCR based bias would be if you go for single molecule sequencing, where there won't be any step like PCR. And now system is coming, smart. Baswar presented the system, Fake Bio, where they are not going for PCR, emulsion PCR. They are ligating fake DNA polymerase on the well, lower side of the well, and subjecting that single fragment itself for PCR. They are amplifying the signals generated out of incorporation of single nucleotide, and they are getting reads. So there won't be bias of PCR. At least bias of PCR can be eliminated with single molecule sequencing. Now the one more thing which is tricky is assembly. Now who will tell me the difference between all these five terminologies? Read, contig, scaffold, netware and parentage. First preference is to participants. What is the difference between read, contig and scaffold?
It is the any sequence.
That has been obtained.
And then contig is the resemblance of the
experimentally, single experimentally obtained DNA or RNA sequence.
And contig is when we
fragments are
when more we align two more than two or n number of reads to make a contiguous fragment.
Okay, set of overlapping DNA or RNA reads. Now stay for
this is for filling the gap or something when you are aligning, sometimes filling that gap you can see that.
After alignment of
overlapping.
The next stage is scaffold. Will use like first stage reads, multiple reads, then aligned may lead to contig and multiple contig as well. Understand it.
Multiple contig will never align. How it can align?
Right. And next stage is
gap filling and whatever gaps are there, they are filled up and filling.
Scaffold is on the basis of
except Namrata, Subhas and Joshi sir, who will tell me what is the difference between scaffold and contig?
It is like overlap alignment of the contig.
One is from pair.
Scaffolds are over alignment of the contig.
That will never happen. Contig cannot be aligned to each other. Overlapping won't be there in contig. There will be some gaps present in between two contigs. Otherwise, it's a single contig only.
This is the contigs between the pair and its.
No.
You are adjusting the distance between two contigs. Any two contigs are there, how much apart they are, or what is the distance between two contigs?
That
you adjust.
It is for this, like you have generated two into 300, they are telling. That means 300 from this, 26 nucleotides from this side and 26 nucleotides this side. That is pair ending. This is pair endings. In mate pair, sequences might be 5 kb, 6 kb, and you are from a single clone, you are reading 2 prime. So, what is the difference between contig and scaffold? Scaffold is a series of contig where you are sure that this is contig number 1, after that, I have some gap, and then it is contig number 2. That means contig in a right order with probably most of the time it is with gap, that is called a scaffold. If you have generated huge amount of data for 3 MB bacteria, you can result into a single contig. There won't be scaffold. It's a single contig. That means within a single coverage, starting from one point, you are sequencing your whole genome. It won't be scaffold. When you are calling it as a scaffold, that means there are some contigs, but you are able to identify this is amount of gap present between these two contigs. This is contig number 1, this is contig number 2, and this is contig number 3. That is called a scaffold. Mate pair and parent, we have seen, if we are telling, your insert size is 300 base pair, and if you are reading 26 nucleotides, that means this is 300, 25 from this side and 25 from that side. This is parent. And they are, if you are taking 5 kb or 6 kb fragment, a single larger clone, if you are reading 2 ends, that is mate pair. Okay, now whether we should...
That terminology changes...
Which system, sequencing system?
Based on the platforms they are using.
Now you tell me whether we should go for assembly of our data in metagenomic project or not. Now this is specific to metagenomic project only. If you are assembling, it has got some disadvantages, or you are creating some bias, or you are creating ambiguity within by assembling itself. Whether to go for assembly or we should not go for assembly. See, if it is a single genome, it is very easy job. You have taken DNA, fragmented it, and now you are assembling. That means it's easy job. But when you have taken environmental genome, that means DNA from so many organisms, now you have created smaller pieces, and to reassemble this will always be problematic. It will be difficult. So I'll show you both advantages as well as disadvantages of this. If you are using single read, it has got lower quality and lower confidence. That means lower accuracy than using multiple reads. If you are using multiple reads for same region, that means amount, confidence and accuracy in identifying that region will be high. But this will happen when you will assemble your data. If you are not assembling your data, directly subjecting your reads to some software, that means level of confidence will be less. Merging the reads will increase quality of information. If at all you are getting some from smaller read length, if you are getting higher read length, that means you have produced longer reads, which has got more chances of homology or composition-based binning, and it will accurately identify the organisms. Chances will be high if you are going for assembly. Obviously, in a complex community with low sequencing depth or low coverage, it is unlikely to actually get many reads that covers the same region of DNA. Hence, assembly may be a limited value for metagenomic study. But if you are not doing assembly, you are missing regions like CRISP, which is important part in bacteria and many archaea. 90% of the archaea are having this region, reported to this region. And if you are not going for assembly, that means longer region like this complex region will be missed out. So it has got advantage as well as disadvantage both. When you are assembling your result, see if it is shorter reads and this is longer reads. Longer reads will always be better. The article of this OMR title itself is Does Read Length Matter? Metagenomics, does read length matter? The article is fully based on this only. It will tell advantage as well as disadvantage of this. Title of article itself is Metagenomic, does read length matter? Shorter reads with high, you need a higher coverage, then you will be able to assemble something. Longer read, even with less coverage, whatever information you are getting, that will be high. The problems which can happen with shorter reads is, you consider this as a unique sequences. On this side also it is a unique sequences. And this much region is repetitive regions, like microsatellites or mini-satellites. Okay. If your read length itself is 30-40 base pair, which is lesser than this, so whatever reads you are getting, that cannot be assembled. But if you are having read length which is larger than this, say 600 base pair, now it will get some unique part assembled over here, and some unique part get assembled over here. So now you can say this is the complex region, repetitive region. I have identified having some flanking region which is unique. Here also it is unique region. So longer reads will always be better for any of metagenomic study. You can assemble your data and you will get more information out of it. So these are the difficulty associated with shorter read length, difficulty in alignment, less sensitivity, and this is one classical example of this. Only 25% of gram movement sequences having average read length of 114 base pair could be annotated using GeneBank. Whereas 75% of the cow rumen sequences having a read length of 430 base pair instead of 140 could be annotated using the same database with the same parameter. That means by using same database, the difference was only in read length. 140 base pair you can annotate only 25%. If you are increasing read length to 430 base pair, more than 75% can be annotated. That means higher the read length, better will be the assembly, and better you can identify the protein or some function associated with that sequence. And even though with lack of knowledge of species of origin of the sequence, classification of 40 to 93% of the reads are up to genus level only. And classification of 13 to 65% of the reads are going up to the species level. When you are telling assembly, chimeric read will again create a problem. Chimeric reads are, again I am reminding, chimeric reads are reads which are produced from two different fragments. Though it is in a single line, but it is from two different fragments. Now this will create a problem in assembly. If there are more chimeric reads from same regions or regions having some sequence similarity, it will create a problem in your assembly. Or if you have used a system which are having higher error rate, which has introduced some frameshift mutations or some insertion deletions or duplicates or artificial reads, that means they are not the actual reads. If you are getting so many reads which are where starting point is same and ending point is same, that means it's a artificial read, so duplicate reads. Generally whatever fragmentation we are doing, that is random, so we won't get so many sequences at a time having exact sequence similarity and read length identified. So annotation can be possible by using reference based assembly. That means you are comparing your sequence with reference. Or it could be de novo. That means you give parameter that 40 base pair overlap with 90% accuracy or 90% homology and make some cutting out of it. Or initially you go for clustering, you identify the nearly identical reads, make a group and then go for assembly of your data. This will reduce the amount of data need to be handled. Now everybody is using all type of reads. You can submit raw reads also, you can submit contigs also for your metagenomic analysis. The problems associated with short reads can be solved by some extent by increasing the data coverage. Therefore, there you need enough money to increase the data coverage. But it can be solved. Or your stringent parameter and filtering criteria to identify the chimeric breeds also. There are some software which removes the chimeric, which identify and removes the chimeric breeds. And your stringent criteria, that lower quality below this needs to be trimmed, and then you assemble your data. Or else you can try binning. We'll see what is binning. Or the last option is you use single molecule sequencing or nanopore sequencing. See, this system is in market, we won't discuss much, but it's a single molecule real-time sequencing where there won't be any stain. This is smart cell, zero mode waveguide. This is pyrus, take DNA polymerase or DNA polymerase, their single molecule is getting sequenced every time. Whatever amount of fluorescence generated are getting magnified and identified, since each and every base is having different fluorophores, so it will emit different amount of color. Regen, they are telling it is producing up to 15 kb. Now they are telling 15 kb regen. And coverage, with coverage, with increasing coverage, accuracy is at par. See, here definition of accuracy is different. They are not calling it, they say our single read will be 99.9% accurate. Single read might be 90% accurate only. But if you are generating multiple reads for same region, accuracy will go high, up to 99.9999%. Now it is at par with any of the sequencing system available in the market. Okay. That means single read less coverage in case of SMRT is not desirable, but if you increase the coverage, accuracy will be at par with other sequencing system like ILI or GSFX. Again, marriage between chemistry and physics, we have nothing to do in this. It's a nanopore sequencing, a small hole from where DNA is passed without amplified. It's a single molecule sequencing. Again, an amount of voltage generated will be different in case of AT, G, and C. So it will identify the sequence, nanopore sequencing. And one more is
so this nanopore sequencing system is available now?
Or I don't think it is available in market.
Beta version.
They are being?
Beta version, they have placed at certain places.
Okay.
But for sale it is not available.
For testing they are giving muscles to laboratories. It's a process of sorting DNA sequence into a group that might represent a individual genomes or genome of closely related organism. Again, I am repeating, it's a process of sorting of the sequences which represent either a single genome or genomes of closely related species. Now, things depend upon how much read length you are having. 75 base pair, that means you need to go for later one, closely related genomes. If it is 500 base pair or 800 base pair, you can accurately say that these are from this particular organism only. And in binning, what we will do? It could be composition based binning. See, binning could be of two types. One is composition based binning. In composition based binning, see, all of you must be knowing that bacteria is having varying amount of GC percent. In afternoon only, madam was telling that the GC percent in her organism is 80% is higher.
80.
Okay. There are some bacteria which are having 75% or 80% GC. So what this, in this process, what we will do is, we will take sequence, 800 base pair long sequence, and we will see GC percent. If it is higher GC percent, that will be in separate group. If it is having low GC percent, that means 80% is high, that will be clubbed into separate group. That is binning based on, that means grouping of the sequences based on GC percent. The another option with in composition based binning is, you identify some repeats which are present in particular species only. If you are getting crisps, then there are more chances that sequence is from archaea, because 90% of archaea is having that particular sequence. If you are having some microsatellite type of repeats, then the sequence could be of some specific organism only. That means based on this, you can bin your sequences. And binning is just done at initial stage, just to reduce amount of data which you need to handle afterward. But again, problem associated with binning is if your read length is too less, say 100 base pair. And from 100 base pair, if you are identifying DC person, 50 or 60 or 35, chances of misinterpretation might be more. If your read length is high, binning might be more accurate. For composition based binning, you can use either of this software. We'll give copy of this presentation to you. So you can use either of this software for similarity based binning. See, another method of binning is similarity. That means homology based binning. If your sequences, whether it is 100 base pair or 500 base pair, are matching with sequences which are available in database, they are grouped together. It is called as similarity based binning. That means sequences which are sharing sequence homology will be grouped together. That is similarity based binning. These are the softwares which are doing similarity based binning. And these two are using both composition based binning as well as sequence similarity based binning. Now next one will be annotation. From sequence to prediction of some function. When you have generated some sequences, let it be too high, too huge in amount. But until and unless you will draw some meaningful conclusion out of this, it will be FTGC only. If you are identifying some function associated with that particular sequence, that is meaningful. Otherwise, it's a junk for everybody. And in metagenome study, whatever data which are generated, that will be too high and again too complex. So manual annotation is not possible. Otherwise, ideal is that you take one sequence, go for blast, and I try to identify the similarity, what it is. But that is not possible. So most of the times we are using automated pipelines for annotation. That you submit your sequences, MGRAST, what you are doing? You are doing automatic annotation. There are so many web-based tools where you can go for automatic annotation. Here also, the problem will be same. See, most of the software now, they are coming at par. Initially, there are some differences that RAST, MGRAST was using only assembled rigs, not raw rigs. But now they have started using raw rigs also. Annotation means two steps. First one is feature prediction, that means process of labeling sequences to a gene or genomic element. And second one will be function annotation. That means assigning putative gene function or to an taxonomic neighbors to that particular sequence. Commonly used pipelines for annotation will be homology based binning. That means your sequence, if it is sharing some sequence similarity with already identified nucleotide sequence, that will be annotated at that particular protein. Another one will be motif or pattern based approach, where this will be initiation codon, this will be the termination codon, and this will be the probable protein. Bioinformatician will take care of this. Or context based approach. Or there are some spatial database, you submit your sequences, it will identify the sequence related to CRIPS, or adhesin or some protein localization. Kazine example of that only. You submit your sequences, it will identify the sequences which are responsible for carbohydrate metabolism. See, for most of the gene prediction using CD, they are using this PREG gene scan, metagene scan or metagene annotator, MGA. PREG gene scan is best as per the observation of these two scientists. It results into 1-2% error, and true positive rates of PREG gene scan is 70%, better than most of the other methods available right now. With this also, we are identifying 70% true result. That means we are missing 30%. 30% are false positive. We have seen web tools which are available for NGS data analysis, so we won't go in detail. I think we have taken enough time also. MGRAST, IGMG, Camera, Mega, I think we have seen detail of each and every one. But still problem lies this. Problem associated with this is whatever reads or content you have produced that you are submitting to some database and you are annotating your sequence. But problem is you can see only what is in the database. That means many a times if you are taking novel metagenome, where many of the reads will be without annotation. Without annotation, that means it is useless. Okay. So again, you test your reads with 2-3 more database, manually blast will be the option. If you are not getting any annotation in NGRAS, take their sequence, go for manual blast, identify some proteins out of that. That could be the alternative. But we do not have 100% possible solution for this. Whatever will be there in database, that will be reflected in the region. The another problem is computational requirement. If you are keeping your machine with you, amount of data generated with every run will get accumulated and you will see the requirement. That will be in TB, 12 TB, 1 TB, 6 TB, 9 TB. Except Sanger, where you can store your data on normal laptop or computer. So you need to have some space where you can store your data. And again, if you are doing comparative metagenomics, that means if you are interested that your result could be compared with someone else's result, or if you wish to compare your result with somebody else already reported results, for comparative metagenomics, there should be something, or there should be some portal where you can share your data with other scientists, other group of scientists. Okay, that means you are putting your data to NGRAS, make it publicly accessible, other one can access, but again it has got some limitations. Initially NCBI, I think 2012 or 2013, NCBI, they have declared that we will store all the data available with metagenomic experiments. But later on they realized that broad of data getting produced by using this, now they have stopped using SFF file. They won't store SFF file, they will store FASTRQ file only. It won't be possible for them also to store all the data produced in NGS experiments. The only possible solution to this will be discussed by Dr. G.J. Sarvaiya, cloud computing. If your data are important, you pay somebody to store your data until and unless it is necessary, then you tell them that I don't want this data. Or by the time you pay something to some person or some company, by that time if your capacity means computational advances will happen and you can store GB of data, TB of data on your computer, you can take back. But it has again got problem of piracy and all this that was discussed by Dr. Sarvaiya. But this is possible solution to data sharing and data storage. If you can store your data and or store your data, you need not to buy a software. Some one leader in India can buy a software and that can be given to all the scientific institutes for sharing. Cost will be less. At one place only we are using software.
Do we have that facility in India at present?
Does CDAC store? First thing, they have servers, large amounts of servers. Cloud computing. But I don't know whether for bioinformatics.
Ashoka is also server available with KBIN.
ICR.
But how efficiently they are using that depends. But this is one possible solution that you need not to buy software. Everybody will buy CLC genome workbench. For how many years? One person will buy CLC genomic workbench for transcriptome data analysis. But they are giving genomic suits, which is for everything. miRNA discovery, de novo assembly, resequencing, everything. That means for 10% use, not even 10%, 1% use, because you are using that software for once or twice only. Rather than that, if some other institute is purchasing that machine, though you give higher cost to them, but that can be freely available to all other groups which are working on that particular way. It can even, we need not to store that. Even we need not to bother about updating all. See, since before culturable entities, what we were thinking is culture, bacteria are the only things which are present in nature. But when we have realized that sequencing of uncultivable organisms, now we are telling that 1% is sequenceable, culturable, 99% is non-culturable. So we have got so many things yet to reveal. But you think there could be some organisms which cannot be sequenced. Then what you will tell? 1% is sequenceable organism, 99% will not be sequenced. So this is what we are. I am concluding this. Metagenomic sequencing, obviously, as I told in earlier also, it provides a unique opportunity to explore the Earth's limitless environment, which harbors the bacteria which is unknown. But dedicated tools for for annotation analysis of metagenomic data set, still we do not have one size fit for all. That means we do not have standardized procedure where you submit your data and this will be standardized procedure for soil metagenome. This will be standardized software procedure, sample collection, DNA extraction process for rumen metagenome like that. That means we need to standardize our protocols. And again, is it all database will be useful to you? If your sample is not of human origin, they are less useful to you. If it is human origin, maybe it is useful to you because everybody is working on gut microbes. But if you are using some samples where itself sample itself is unique, in that case database might be having importance but less importance as compared to human data sets. And again, metagenomic is part list of the DNA that could be extracted and the fraction that could be annotated. Again, for result, validation, validation and validation. Go for bioinformatic validation, in situ validation, everything. That means the condition can be described like this. These are the words of Winston Churchill. This is not the end. It is not even the beginning of it. Perhaps it's the end of it. This is where we are in field of metagenomics. Thanks for patience here.
Yes, then there is a danger associated, like if we consider gut microbiome, if we go for, based upon that, if we go for medicine, prescribing the medicine, and if we 30% is we could not identify, and in 30% they contain common cells or against all pathogenic, then there is a lot of danger associated here. For if we say personalized.
It is not danger, it is validation. If it is useful to you, you use it, otherwise throw it away.
But person will die.
That's why they are taking clinical trials.
See, what is happening? Right now also you are taking medicine.
Yes, sir.
Has it proved by metagenomics?
No, sir,
right now also you are taking medicine and that should be matched with the CYP. 490, yeah. Okay, whether you are high metabolizer of that drug or promoter
yeah.
metabolizer, it is not known. Then also it is prescribed, then also you are taking. If you are dying, then it will be recorded. If you are surviving, that also will be recorded. Okay, and that way the science will evolve.
Everybody is taking paracetamol, ibuprofen. Have you ever thought of side effect of that?
Yes.
And everybody is taking, that's why they came to know what is the side effect. That's why they are listening.
Side effect might be lesser than the advantage.
So we have to contribute to the science.
We cannot wait for perfect situation. I will wait for sequencing chemistry, single molecule sequencing, where I can sequence back from this end and it can wait of read sequence up to the end of organism. Whatever is available, you can use it.
So what is your take? Which is the best? What is best?
Which sequencing system is best? It depends upon application. See, I won't give dynamic answer. You name the application, I will give the name of machine.
Milk.
You give the name of application, I will give you the name of machine.
The milk microbiome. So, how much sure, like you are, okay, initially we were saying that there is no bacteria present. Now there are also bacteria present. So, you suggest that platform which was used is okay or? If you would have tried, you would use another strategy.
We are getting so many milk samples which is sterile. But even I have seen that there are some papers which is telling that milk is in some of the microbes.
So, in view of that paper, whatever technology they have used, so do you suggest that had I used the other one?
That's what. You need to validate that. There are some other groups or other group of scientists, if they are getting the same type of organism with other sequencing chemistry, in that case it might be true.
Sequencing chemistry is not going to make mistakes identification. It's sequencing is sequencing. So it's not, no sequencing technology is telling that one is correct, one is wrong. Never, no one has told so far that this is the correct sequencing technology, this is the wrong one. Whatever comparison is, whether it is how much accurate, error rate is how much, that is one thing, okay. So one is telling our error rate is 99%, another is telling 99.9, and third one is telling 99.999, okay. That is the difference. That means sequence that has come, that is not false. But how much is the rate of error in that, that is the matter of discussion. That is the debate, okay. So once we get sequence, that is sequence. There is no challenge to that one.
It could be design of actual processing, sample collection, let me alter your composition. Otherwise sequencing, error rate might be high, error rate might be less.
When we say non-culturable, as per my understanding, we assign non-culturable means that there is no similarity or homology present in our database to that organism. But does that mean that organism is viable but not culturable? Or
now
does that mean that because there are ecological niches where you won't find the organism, viable organism, but you'll find its DNA. So if we are picking the metagenome, the DNA is bound to come there, but in the original niche, the viable organism was not there. So that's what I want to understand.
No. See, glycomics. Do you know the concept of glycomics?
No.
Initially, we thought that genome will be made up of DNA. Then later on, we realized it could be RNA also. Now this, they are coming up with videos. There are some proteins. Protein itself is using your factory, everything like virus, they are causing some disease. That means when genome itself, later on after 10 years we may reveal that except DNA and RNA, protein could be this part of genome. Or rather than this DNA sequencing and all, we can identify something else which could be regulating all these things, everything. Right now we are telling 70% junk genome or 90% junk genome. It may be because of something else which is governing everything.
The same thing is happening in the prions. Prions, that is, still it is going on. Only protein, no nucleic acid.
That type of structure might be present in your metagenome also. It might be regulating everything, whatever you are seeing.
And maybe excluded from the metagenome data.
Huh?
Because the metagenome data have its own bias, because we are targeting nucleic acid only.
Thank you very much.
So after end of this short course, you should feel that God is still great. Okay.
Yeah,
much more greater than what we had got earlier.
Exactly, I was telling to him, there comes the God.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a nice talk. Now I request Subhas sir to please come and felicitate for putting us on a tone of love and appreciation.